After Professor Morante's introduction and welcome, I will chair the first session of this Congress. And it is a pleasure for me to introduce again Professor Morante. He will give the first talk, the first plenary talk. And he's professor of electronics in the University of Barcelona. And he is vice president, for example, of the European Materials Research Society. He's the director of the Catalonia Institute of Energy Research. So he has many awards. He has been directing more than 35 European projects. So let me thank Professor Morante to be here. And the talk he will present today, it's surface chemical reactions at self-heated metal oxide nanowires. So thank you.
Thank you. Well, I am going to talk you one large experience how we was moving from some initial ideas to develop from materials to nanoparticles, through nanowires to device, and finally some applications and some extensions to other fields. So the title is Surface Chemical Reactions and Self-Heating Metal Oxide Nanowires. Well, what is the context that we was working in this topic? Well, smart environments. It's possible to get smart environments. To do this, to get this, is necessary to fulfill the requirements in detecting chemicals in the environments, in the ambient, determining their composition, and this is required for developing a device for smart buildings, smart cities, smart environment. Low cost is one of the conditions, and the other is, okay, we need to determine some chemical concentrations or to identify some chemicals, but to do this, we cannot switch our device. We cannot use wires because this is quite expensive. And then the requirements is you need to apply fully autonomous systems. This means systems that can catch the energy from the ambient. But the capability to catch energy from the ambient is not too much. You need to be in the range of milliwatts. Keep in mind, photovoltaic is one of the more efficient harvesting technologies. And the energy that you can catch is milliwatts. So if you keep in mind how much energy you need to send the information by radio frequency in this fully autonomous system, you need already milliwatts. So it's necessary to develop many, many sensors or many transduction systems consuming very low power. This is the challenge that we was working. The market for this is huge. Well, maybe Samsung has now, in the last time, some problems with some of the device, but one of the novelties from Samsung is to incorporate in the new models of cellular phones chemical sensors included. So this is one example of the huge market for this. What is the history, scientific history? In the 1962, several papers, mainly from Japan, was publishing interesting results. The electrical parameters of metal oxides were changing due to the ambient. So this was the first papers that report chemical to electrical transduction. So many industries was developing products not based on nano materials. But today there are a lot of requirements for intelligent ambients around the house. This is smart buildings. You need these fully autonomous systems. Also, one of the topics is smart cities. You need, again, to control energies, ambience, comfort in the around smart cities. You need a lot of these fully autonomous systems. And then what we can do using materials. Okay, we can use nanoparticles, we can use nanowires. And why nanowires, why nanoparticles? Because we have a large surface area, and then we increase the probability of this chemical to material interaction, chemical to electrical transduction. This is the mechanism that we was analyzing, chemical to electrical transduction. What is the base, the fundamentals of this mechanism? Okay, when you have some absorption of chemicals at the surface, you are modifying the deplexion near the surface. And the electrical resistance of the material is depending on this deplexion. If you have particles or you have even nanowires, you get similar situation. You can see here nanoparticles. This is the technology the first companies developing products was using, and today they move even to use nanowires. In nanoparticles, you have a lot of gram boundaries, contacts problems, and using a mat, a angle of nanowires, you have also similar contacts problems between nanowires. So our objective was, can nanostructured metal oxide materials be one alternative for fulfilling these requirements? It's interesting to use nanowires. Why nanowires? Well, we increase surface to volume ratio. If the nanowires is a perfect nanocrystal, we can increase the stability. We can, if we use one nanowire, maybe we avoid the problems of the grain boundaries. And also, as I am going to explain you, depending of how you are using these nanowires, you can increase the dynamical response of the system. We was preparing nanowires, very simple process, chemical vapor deposition equipment. We prepared these nanowires, but also we was going to the catalysis concept, and we introduced some catalytic elements in the metal oxides nanowires. This is a typical example to show you what we was doing. For example, if you have a tin dioxide, you have this detection of carbon monoxide. Carbon monoxide react at the surface of the tin dioxide, but this reaction can be accelerated, can be catalyzed if you put platinum or if you put palladium, for example. And then this is a modification of the properties at the surface. With these two concepts, we have here nanowires, and we have introduction of catalytic clusters in the nanowire. We was analyzing the crystallographic properties of these nanowires. This is at the beginning, we use the name of nanosticks, but after, this is at the beginning, this mean at the beginning of this century, even the last years of the previous century. And this moment was not an international name for this. It was nanosticks, nano bells, nanowires, nanorods, depending of the geometrical dimension of these structures. That we was improving is to be sure of the crystallographic quality of these nanowires. Also, you can analyze the catalyst interaction with your nanowires. Here is one of the examples. You can see here the high resolution picture and the simulation. This is another example. Here you can see one of these crystallographic nanocrystal structure with a palladium cluster, and then different simulations about this, and also the main consequence, because no time to give you many details. What is the main consequence? That controlling the nanowires properties, high crystallographic quality, and the catalyst was possible to control the chemical reactions at the surface, depending of the temperature. For example, you can see in the top that you can detect electrically carbon monoxide and methane. But if you put some catalyst in some concentrations on other temperature, you can burn very fast the carbon monoxide and no time to transfer this electrical charge to the nanowire, so you don't see any resistance variation. On the contrary, you methane reaction is going slowly and you have time to, at this temperature, to transfer this electron to the nanowire, and you see the modification of the resistance of the nanowire. So it's possible with the catalyst and controlling the surface properties to control the reactions at the surface and the transduction mechanism. So what was the objective? Is why we need many, many nanowires. Why not only one? So that the people, the industry, and many labs was doing preparing materials based on nanoparticles, that you have contacts between the different nanoparticles. Why you need this this change of nanoparticles? Why not only one nanowire? Okay, this is the simulation. You can get many nanoparticles, or you can get only one nanowire, and you are able to make electrical contacts in the nanowire. You can obtain the electrical information. So, transduction from chemical to electrical information, only using one nanowire. You prepare one nanowire, you are manipulating in the lab, you can prepare one nanowire, you can proceed with a focused ion beam to make electrical contacts. You need to move these electrical contacts from the nano wall to the real wall. So from nanometers to millimeters. So this is the change. This is the different steps of contacts just to get in the laboratory the macroscopic contacts that are going to your nanowire. So this is the final result. You can see here the nanowire and four contacts just to eliminate many of the parasitic resistance in one contact. And in this way, it was possible to do many, many analyses and to publish many papers just focused in different aspects and properties. First is the geometrical factors influence. If you are using one nanowire and you make electrical contacts, what is the chemical transduction? What is the influence of the diameter of the nanowire? Well, here you can see in yellow that if you decrease the radius, you can increase the electrical effect, because the deflection at the surface compared with the total diameter is more or less important. Less radius, the deflection is much more important versus the total radius. And in blue is some extrapolation to the nanoparticle size, because it's very easy to get nanoparticles with 3-4 nanometers, and it's quite difficult to manipulate a nanowire with this diameter. Manipulations of nanowires with less than 20 nanometers, it's very complex. But anyway, we prove that the diameter is playing an important role. The second is the response time. Okay. If you are using nanoparticles, gas diffusion is become very, very important. But it's not only gas diffusion to go inside of the different nanoparticles, it's also the products of the reactions need time to go out. And then many of the sensors based on nanoparticles, they are presenting 10-100 seconds of response time. What happens if you have only one nanowire? You can get the nanowire and you don't need diffusion times. So we was proving that this is in the blue line, the slope is indicating the activation energy. And you can see that in some moments, this slope is blocked and become horizontal, because this is the thermal inertia of the nanowire. So the experiment is you have a nanowires, and then you get the gas, you increase the temperature, and then the catalytic reaction takes place. The only limiting factor is the kinetic of the reactions. But in some moment, if you are increasing the temperature of the nanowire, in some moment, here is about 150 centigrades, 200 centigrades, is blocked because you need time to heat the nanowire. This is the response, the thermal inertia response time. This is about 40 in these experiments, in the lab, is about 40 milliseconds. So this means that if you are in low temperatures, that the kinetics of the chemical reaction is going slowly, that this thermal inertia, 40 milliseconds, you can separate what is the response of thermal inertia and what is the chemical reaction. If you increase and you are going faster, you become blocked by the thermal inertia. So this is the more faster chemical sensors that was prepared, because it's not limited for any effect. The other property that was maybe the more important property that we was publishing and communicating to the colleagues working in these topics: self-heating. Self-heating. Here you can see three experiments. We applied to the nanowires, just to see the electrical properties, 100 picoamps. This current is not producing heating by Joule dissipation in the nanowire. What happened if I put one molecule like nitrogen dioxide? This is absorbed, and then the deflection is formed in the nanowire. Resistance is changing. But when I stop the current, no change. This is the blue. No change because we are in low temperature. There are not desorption of the molecules. What happens if I increase the current through the nanowire? The nanowire become a little bit hot. Maybe increase the temperature from the ambient to maybe 18, 19 centigrades. Molecules, absorbed molecules, at these temperatures can be desorbed. And then deflection is diminished. So resistance is changing. What happens if I apply higher level of density of current, like 10 nanoamps? I increase a little bit more the temperature of the nanowire by a Joule dissipation. We can simulate, we was doing this, and we can achieve 150, 180 in the nanowire. What happened with this? When we stop the current, immediately, thermal inertia response, but after this, the molecules are desorbed and the resistance go to zero. So this is the self-heating. We can control the temperature of the nanowire depending of the density of current that we apply. And then, in this way, we can control the range of temperatures, or working temperatures in the nanowire, without external heater. And each gas, each chemical, can react at the surface of one nanowire. You select what metal oxide or what material you are using for the nanowire, what molecule is absorbed, and then you can control in what window of temperatures this molecule is reacting. And you can achieve this temperature, of course, in some limits, with the use of a current that you apply through the nanowire. And the other property that we was optimizing is the optical excitation of nanowires. If you apply UV, you can modify what molecules are absorbed or not, because UV photons has enough energy to change the population of absorbed molecules at the surface of the nanowire. Okay, this is a this is the main idea. As we can apply current, even we can apply impulsed current. We can apply very low level of current, and then a nanowire is a low temperature. You can absorb molecules, and then if you want to clean the surface, you can apply a high level of current, and you increase the temperature, and the molecules are desorbed. So you can play what you have at the surface of the nanowire. And in this way, you can apply all your knowledge to design different concepts, different sensors, or different transductions from chemical to electrical parameters. And this was using a simple nanowire. What was the problem? Well, this is working in the laboratory. This is working in the laboratory, but this is not for industrial application, because you cannot manipulate one nanowire in the industrial production process. One important question: what is the consumption of energy in this nanowire, in this device? Less than 30 microwatts. So this is ideal for any fully autonomous system, because the consumption of energy to do this is less than 30 microwatts. What is the consumption of the commercial sensors? Microsensors are today around 50, maybe some 30 milliwatts. This is microwatts, it's three orders of magnitude. And the classical technology was watts. So this is using nanowires, we decrease six orders of magnitudes the consumption of energy. Okay, many attempts to involve these nanowires for industrial applications, and then to use some micro-mechanized substrates to allocate the nanowires, but this was not working. And finally, we was applying the dielectric forces of a solution of nanowires. This is a very simple idea. You can get a drop with many nanowires, and you can apply on the top of interdigitated electrodes, and then applying AC voltage. You can try playing with these nanowires and the solution. You can apply the orientation of these nanowires, and finally you can allocate these nanowires between the interdigitated electrodes. Here is different examples, very simple idea, but this is working, and then you can get many, many nanowires in parallel. So this, you don't lose any of the properties that I explained you now, and you can combine a density of nanowires depending of the density of the solution. This is working. Even you can analyze by simulation where the nanowires will be allocated depending of the electrical field intensity. You can see some effects in the corners. You can apply this to different materials. Some materials are much more easy to manipulate in the electric forces, others not. Of course, there are a problem. If you have you put physically the electrode, the nanowires on the top of the interdigitized electrodes, but you need to apply some heat to try to enhance the contact between the electrode and the nanowire. This is this electrical figures. You can do this, and you get the example. Multi-parallel nanowires, individual nanowires, in one device, you can test. If you apply one nanoamp through, now is one nanoamp because you divide this nanowire, this one nanoamp among the different nanowires that you have. No answer. This is the black line. You put 2.5, you can see that if you change the ambient, there are electrical response. And when you apply 5 nanoamps, you can see that the electrical response is going. So this is even you can compare your electrical response based in the self-heating with the external heating. And you can see that it's not so different. So you get the same effect, but by self-heating. And even you can get here some simulations and some experimental confirmations of what is the temperature in the nanowire depending of the current that you apply. This is working as device, and I can show you that if you are you have a nice nanocrystal based in a nanowire, you can implement here. This is very big, but this is based in these nanowires. This is a thermoelectric harvesting system. This means this take energy from the ambient to the temperature of the human body. This is a thermal gradient from the ambient is 21 to the human body temperature is 36. It's about 15 centigrades of the gradient. The thermoelectrics is converting this temperature gradient to electrical energy. When the, I can repeat, when the lady put this in on the hand, the thermoelectric is working, is communicating energy, and then the sensor is going to the top, and then she blew, this is changing the ambient, and the sensor is modifying the resistance. Now, when again she put on the table, not more electrical energy supplied because the thermoelectric generator is blocked, and then this go to zero. And the consumption of this is microwatts. So you need much more energy for communications. Okay, so as conclusion is self-heating in nanowires become a very interesting properties. If you control the quality of your nanowires, you can control the sensitivity of your transduction element. You can improve the response time because you avoid the diffusion of the chemical specimens because you have a much more open space. You can get also the possibility to illuminate the material, and this is ideal for fully autonomous systems based on these multi-nanowires integrated systems. That is a process that you can be implemented at the industrial level. And just to end, to say that these ideas today are moved to new fields, like, for example, to develop three-dimensional electrodes based on these nanowires. And then with these three-dimensional electrodes, today are used in some examples of improved electrodes for batteries, electrochemical batteries, or also for photoelectrochemical systems. Here, for example, you can see electrode based on three-dimensional structures. Here, one electrical contact is the supporting substrate, and the other here is changing because the other electrical contact is the electrolyte, liquid electrolyte, but you can control the temperature through these three-dimensional materials through the level of current that you apply. And in this way, we can get, for example, a solar to hydrogen conversion of around 50%. That this is similar that photovoltaics, many photovoltaics modules offer, they get. So directly from the sun, we can produce, for example, in this case is hydrogen. But this is one example, a nice example of these ideas manipulating nanowires can be used, applied for develop advanced electrodes for getting much competitive performance. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Juan Ramon. We have time for a few questions, so is anybody? Yes, please.
Thank you very much for a very interesting presentation. Thank you for the presentation. I'm curious about the concept of
self-heating of a nanowire, in the sense that you fix the temperature by fixing the current. But when you interact with the molecule, probably you change the resistance, so maybe you also change the temperature of a single wire. How can you feedback the process, which is typically at a constant temperature for nanowires?
Yeah. Well, no time to show you many details, but of course there are some re-equilibrium, and you can see this if when you analyze the response time, because you can see when you analyze the response time, if you are controlling very well the temperature, you get a perfect kinetic described by only one time constant. Okay. When you are in a more complex situation, you can see that there are some deformation of this single kinetic response. And this is due to this re-equilibrium of temperature.
Yes, please.
I just wanted to know, how do you monitor the temperature of the nanowire at the experimental stage?
Yeah. We are more... we are using these micro-mechanized substrates on silicon. And then that we are, well, I don't know. So really, when the nanowire is working on self-heating, really we don't know exactly what is the temperature of the nanowire. We are determining what is the kinetics, because the reaction have a kinetics that is fixed at one temperature. So, and then, I show you one plot, what there are temperature and there are density of current. This temperature is not the temperature of the nanowire. This is the temperature that in a system that we heat externally is the temperature that we was needed to put. Okay? But if you try to get... during the self-heating, you try to know the temperature, and then your measurement systems are perturbing your nanowire. So this is, this experimentally. By simulation, and then we corroborate this correlation by simulation.
And maybe the last question?
And you drop it on the floor. Do nanowires like snap, or how durable is this?
Sorry?
So like let's say you take your device with your nanowires, yes. Like the single ones in the arrays, and you build a device with it, and say you drop the device on the floor. So have you done any durability testing with this kind of stuff? Like does it snap, or is it like how long does it last?
Well, I don't know if I understand your question, but you ask if why we are using this complex of nanowires.
No, how durable your nanowires are, yeah, towards physical.
If the system fall on the floor, yeah, how durable is? I mean,
ah,
if they can,
okay,
resist or they fall.
No, okay. No, the system, this was a laboratory prototype, but this was working... this was to demonstrate that... these systems is consuming very low level of energy. The objective was to use this thermogenerator to demonstrate that with very small level of energy, these systems was working. And then this system was in the lab during many months without presenting any important degradation of the characteristics. So each time that you was doing that I show in the video, this was a reproducible system. Even the problem is surface can be degraded due to some contamination to be in the ambient. And then we apply these properties of illumination, UV illumination, just to try to clean. Or we apply even some strong current pulse just to try to remove all the contaminated absorption of different chemical specimens. In this way, we back again to the same level of signal, and the behavior was repetitive. In fact, when we tried to do some testing from the industrial point of view, this means repetitivity, we don't have any problem about this.
That's thank again, Professor Morante, for this interesting talk. And now let me introduce you the next plenary speaker for this first session. It will be Professor Alberto Bomiero. He's chair professor in experimental physics at the Luleå University of Technology in Sweden. And his PhD was awarded in electronic engineering in the University of Trento. He obtained also a degree in physics from University of Padova, and his main interests are composite nanomaterials, wide bandgap semiconductors, semiconducting nanocrystals, and hybrid systems. And the talk today will be about composite nanostructures for high energy, for high efficiency excitonic solar cells.
Thank you very much for a kind introduction while we're waiting for the slides. And thank you very much to the organizers of the conference for giving me the opportunity of illustrating the results I obtained in my research in last year's. Results have been produced essentially in at CNR in Italy and then in Canada at INRS, where I stayed a couple of years, and now in Luleå University of Technology in Sweden. Thank you, great. Today I will be talking about the possibility of tuning nanomaterials properties for a specific application in solar energy and mainly in solar cells, excitonic solar cells. Let me give you just a brief panoramic view of development in the field of solar cells. In the first, so-called the first generation solar cell was mainly based on single crystalline and polycrystalline.